Author's note. Shortly after Donald Trump's inauguration as the 45th President of the United States, I was allowed into the West Wing as a sideline observer. My book, Fire and Fury, was the resulting account of the organizational chaos and constant drama, more psychodrama than political drama, of Trump's first 7 months in office. Here was a volatile and uncertain president releasing, almost on a daily basis, his strange furies on the world and at the same time on his own staff. The first phase of the most abnormal White House in American history ended in August 2017 with the departure of Chief Strategist Stephen K. Bannon and the appointment of retired General John Kelly as Chief of Staff. This new account begins in February 2018. At the outset of Trump's second year in office, with the situation now profoundly altered. The president's capricious furies have been met by an increasingly organized and methodical institutional response. The wheels of justice are inexorably turning against him. In many ways, his own government, even his own White House, has begun to turn on him. Virtually every power center left of the far right wing has deemed him unfit. Even some of his own base find him undependable, hopelessly distracted, and in over his head. Never before has a president been under such concerted attack with such a limited capacity to defend himself. His enemies surround him, dedicated to bringing him down. I am joined in my train wreck fascination with Trump, that certain knowledge that in the end he will destroy himself, by, I believe, almost everyone who has encountered him since he was elected president. To have worked anywhere near him is to be confronted with the most extreme and disorienting behavior possible. That is hardly an overstatement. Not only is Trump not like other presidents, he is not like anyone most of us have ever known. Hence, everyone who has been close to him feels compelled to try to explain him and in fact to dine out on his head-smacking peculiarities. It is yet one more of his handicaps. All the people around him, however much they are bound by promises of confidentiality or non-disclosure agreements or even friendship, cannot stop talking about their experience with him. In this sense, he is more exposed than any president in history. Many of the people in the White House who helped me during the writing of Fire and Fury are now outside of the administration, yet they are as engaged as ever by the Trump saga. I am grateful to be part of this substantial network. Many of Trump's pre-White House cronies continue both to listen to him and support him. At the same time, as an expression both of their concern and of their incredulity, they report among one another and to others as well on his temper, mood, and impulses. In general, I have found that the closer people are to him, the more alarmed they have found themselves at various points about his mental state. They all speculate about how this will end. Badly for him, they almost all conclude. Indeed, Trump is probably a much better subject for writers interested in human capacities and failings than for most of the reporters and writers who regularly cover Washington and who are primarily interested in the pursuit of success and power. My primary goal in Siege is to create a readable and intuitive narrative. That is its nature. Another goal is to write the near equivalent of a real-time history of this extraordinary moment, since understanding it well after the fact might be too late. A final goal is pure portraiture. Donald Trump is an extreme, almost hallucinatory, and certainly cautionary American character. To accomplish this, to gain the perspective and to find the voices necessary to tell the larger story, I provided anonymity to any source who requested it. In cases where I have been told, on the promise of no attribution, about an unreported event or private conversation or remark, I have made every effort to confirm it with other sources or documents. In some cases, I have witnessed the events or conversations described herein. With regard to the Mueller investigation, the narrative I provide is based on internal documents given to me by sources close to the office of the special counsel. Dealing with sources in the Trump White House has continued to offer its own set of unique issues. A basic requirement of working there is surely the willingness to infinitely rationalize or delegitimize the truth and, when necessary, to outright lie. In fact, I believe this has caused some of the people who have undermined the public trust to become private truth tellers. This is their devil's bargain. But for the writer, interviewing such Janus-faced sources creates a dilemma, for it requires depending on people who lie to also tell the truth, and who might later disavow the truth they have told. Indeed, the extraordinary nature of much of what has happened in the Trump White House is often baldly denied by its spokespeople, as well as by the president himself. Yet in each successive account of this administration, the level of its preposterousness, even as that bar has been consistently raised, has almost invariably been confirmed. In an atmosphere that promotes and frequently demands hyperbole, tone itself becomes a key part of accuracy. For instance, most crucially, the president, by a wide range of the people in close contact with him, is often described in maximal terms of mental instability. "I have never met anyone crazier than Donald Trump," is the wording of one staff member who has spent almost countless hours with the president. Something like this has been expressed to me by a dozen others with firsthand experience. How do you translate that into a responsible evaluation of this singular White House? My strategy is to show and not tell, to describe the broadest context, to communicate the experience, to make it real enough for a reader to evaluate for him or herself where Donald Trump falls on a vertiginous sliding scale of human behavior. It is that condition, an emotional state rather than a political state, that is at the heart of this book. Michael Wolff, April 2019.